Grid. Straight grids draw cities like checkerboards. The idea dates to ancient Greece and became famous with New York's 1811 plan. Blocks share one shape, so land is easy to sell, utilities repeat, and addresses stay simple. Fire crews know every corner. Long lines, however, trap heat and speed traffic. So many towns now break the grid with pocket parks, bike lanes, and slow street zones. Extra shade trees cool the hot paving in summer and keep the map clear for drivers and walkers alike. Organic Medieval. Old quarters in Fez, Kyoto, or York formed a lane at a time with no central map. Paths twist around wells, markets, and slopes, making a shaded maze that stays cool. Hidden courtyards appear without warning. Cars fit poorly, but foot trade thrives. Tourists enjoy getting pleasantly lost. Upgrades add street numbers, LED lamps, and fiber under the stones. Roof gutters feed cisterns to water plants, so the living history keeps growing while basic services reach each tiny door. Baroque. Baroque plans fire grand avenues from a hub like wheel spokes. Paris, Washington, D.C., and Karlsruhe line these axes with palaces, museums, or statues at every vista. Round plazas handle many roads at once, and twin rows of trees give shade. Building such drama costs more than a grid, and traffic can clog the center, so modern fixes add light rail rings and bike bypasses. Lawns between the spokes host festivals and marches without closing cross-town travel. Garden City. Ebenezer Howard's 1898 Garden City rings homes, jobs, and farms with a green belt. Letchworth and Canberra still show tree-lined streets, small centers, and parks 5 minutes from any door. The belt block sprawl yet lets farmers sell local food. Later, car suburbs copied only the lawns and lost the walking links. New eco-towns restore the full idea, using solar roofs, light rail, and bike lanes to keep the belt intact. Ideal size is about 50,000 people, big enough for schools, yet crossable on foot. Radiant City. Le Corbusier pictured tall slabs and open lawns with fast roads below. Brasilia and Chandigarh proved the concept. Sun and breeze reach each flat, but a corner shop may sit 20 minutes away and streets feel empty at night. Pelotas raise homes for airflow, yet leave blank ground that draws graffiti. Cities now weave cafes, bike lanes, and mixed uses under the towers, softening the concrete while keeping good light and daily fresh air for residents. Superblock. Barcelona's new superblocks, Vauban in Germany, and parts of Copenhagen group 9 normal blocks into one big zone. Cars circle outside. Inside streets belong to walkers and bikes. Noise and fumes fall, and kids play safely. Deliveries still reach doors, but at slow speed. Critics fear edge roads will jam, yet early tests show cleaner air and rising shop sales. Pocket gardens fill former parking bays, proving calm streets can also boost local business. Transit-oriented development. Hong Kong, Singapore, and Arlington pack homes, shops, and offices within a short walk of rail stops. High-density funds, the trains and slashes car use. Active shopfronts keep streets busy day and night. Clear lifts, ramps, and signs let older people move easily. Rents can spike if supply is tight, so new rules set aside mixed-income units. When land stays open for new towers, the station core grows without pushing out long-time residents. New Urbanism. Seaside, Florida, and Poundbury revive small blocks, front porches, and mixed-use main streets. Narrow roads, slow cars, sidewalks, and corner stores pull neighbors outside. Houses sit close to the curb, making eyes on the street. Critics call some projects stage-set perfect, and note commuters still drive far for work. Yet surveys show high resident pride and strong foot traffic in lively public squares. Many suburbs now retrofit these village tricks. Car-oriented suburbia. Post-war suburbs from Los Angeles to Mississauga grew around the car. Curved streets, cul-de-sacs, and big parking lots make driving easy but walking hard. Homes sit on wide lawns, and single-use zoning separates houses from shops and jobs. Commutes grow long, and buses struggle with low density. Towns now add bike trails, bus lanes, and corner cafes to cut traffic and give streets some life. But retrofitting can cost more than early mixed planning. Eco, Hammarby Sjöstad and Bishan Ang Mo Kio Park fold green tech into daily life. Wetland beds clean runoff, porous paths drink storms, solar roofs power lamps, and waste heat warms homes. Boards show live data on liters cleaned and carbon saved. School trips log frog calls with phone apps, turning a play day into science. By hiding pipes under lawns and slides, the city becomes a working climate lab that families can touch. Megablock. Shenzhen's OCT loft and Singapore's pinnacle at Duxton Place, housing on giant podiums that hide parking and shops. Lifts open onto roof decks with jogging tracks, playgrounds, and breezy views. Fewer street crossings mean safer walks, but blank podium walls can deaden sidewalks. Designers now install art, cafes, and trees at ground level to keep streets active, while residents enjoy garden space 40 stories up. Informal, Dharavi in Mumbai and Rotinha in Rio rose fast without formal plans. Families add rooms as money allows, using brick, tin, or wood. Lanes are narrow, but street trade booms and dense life supports clinics and schools. Water lines, sewers, and legal titles lag behind. NGOs help lay pipes and lights while mapping each alley. Though living conditions can be tough, strong social ties and micro-businesses keep these areas vibrant parts of the wider city. Linear. From Spain's 1882 corridor plan to Saudi Arabia's new NEOM line, planners sometimes stretch the city into one long ribbon. Rail or highway runs the length, with layered homes, jobs, and parks beside it. Using less land and cutting trip time sound good, but critics question daylight, escape routes, and huge costs. Only short examples, like Villanova's Rambla, work today. Yet the idea still sparks debate about how slim a city can safely be. Polycentric. Stockholm's post-war ABC suburbs and China's Pearl River Delta link many self-contained towns around a main core by rail. Each satellite offers housing, A, jobs, B, and a center, C, so daily life stays local while trains connect the region. The spread eases downtown crowding and shares growth, but it needs frequent rail service. If trains are late to open, satellites turn into long-drive dormitory towns instead of balanced mini-cities. Thanks for watching this video. Got some ideas for upcoming videos? Let me know in the comments down below. Also, be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell. It really helps pushing the videos out.